Right, well, welcome back. This is the fifth panel, and I'm Andrew Bailey, and chair it. At the risk of paraphrasing Bill Bryson, this is a short panel about nearly everything. I think I can promise you climate change, aging populations, and cryptocurrencies. And the idea is that if you can all write down on a small piece of paper how those three could imaginatively put together, we'll pick the winner out. But we're lucky to have with us Michael Kumhof, who's just joined us, Nick Stern, and Tim Harford. And I think we're going to go in that order. So, Michael, over to you.
So we're back in sequence now. This is panel five, theme five of the research agenda, response to fundamental change. The motivation for including this in the research agenda is that we think that there's a number of challenging developments, not just in the financial sector, but also in society and the real economy that could ultimately trigger monetary and financial stability problems. And that central banks will have to anticipate as much as possible these challenges, be quite forward-thinking there, and to respond to them when they lead to acute problems, but preferably the first. Now, this is a little overview of these key challenges. As just mentioned, they are very diverse. And I won't be able to talk about every one of them in detail, but here's an overview. So the technical innovations in the financial sector is what we see as one potential challenge. Two examples, digital currencies. Both the payments and the credit systems may have to adjust to that if that becomes a more significant player. Peer-to-peer lending, crowdfunding, that could become potentially, we don't know, a competition for bank credit. We would then need to understand through research how that would impact bank credit. The second broad topic, I will be able to say a little bit more about that, demographics and more specifically aging. That would require adjustments in insurance markets, in asset prices, in interest rates. Obviously very important for central bank policy if that happens. Related, but not the same, increased income inequality could lead to lower interest rates if the rich have a higher saving propensity. And also to greater financial fragility. And finally, climate change, very broad topic with many, many facets. One of them is that if this comes to pass, the real economy will have to be comprehensively restructured. And this could lead to problems in certain sectors, for example, stranded assets in industries that are heavily dependent on fossil fuels. And in some of those industries, then obviously credit problems that could affect the financial system. Also, catastrophes could reduce world growth if they become more frequent, and they would affect the insurance sector, again, of course, of core interest for the Bank of England. I will now briefly talk about two of those topics in more detail. One of them is, why might central banks issue digital currencies? The choice for central banks when faced with the changes in technology in financial markets is to either be reactive, to monitor and then respond to developments as they happen, or to be proactive, which in the case of digital currencies might mean to issue digital currencies themselves. And one motivation for that might be that if this is done right, it could contribute to greater financial stability. Of course, What that means, doing it right, given that we know so little about it so far, is something that requires an enormous amount of research. Now, if central banks issue digital currencies, there are costs and benefits, and on the next slide I will also talk about some of the central policy issues. On the costs and benefits, on financial stability, there is a potential cost, and that is that the effects of such digital currencies on the existing settlement and credit institutions at this moment in time are hard to predict. But the benefit to offset that is that a central bank issued digital currency might be a more easily controlled means of settlement and exchange. The trade-off between those two is a topic for research. Regulation, the cost is that with this technology, there are currently many unresolved issues that the regulator would need to understand. But the benefit is that regulation can, in principle, be simpler because with these institutions, there are not necessarily any credit risk issues. because they would be intermediating a means of settlement. Seigneurage, the cost there is that under digital currencies, identification and verification may have significantly higher real resource costs than other settlement means of settlement. But on the other hand, the benefit is that if the central bank itself were to issue a digital currency, those costs would, of course, be significantly reduced. Now, the key policy questions in each one of them would lead, in my opinion, to two or three very interesting research papers. Under monetary control, who would receive a digital currency if a central bank were to issue it? Would it only be the banks for interbank settlement? Would it include non-bank financial institutions, households and firms? Open questions. How would public digital and private credit-based currency compete? That's something that we have no experience with at this point, or very little. How would the monetary transmission mechanism change? And what policy instruments would the central bank have, including instruments that at this point do not exist yet, to influence this process? That's under monetary control. Prudential regulatory control, what are the implications for government-backed deposit insurance when there's central bank-issued digital currency? How does it affect competition between that currency and credit-based money? And finally, how do we regulate these institutions that offer access to digital currencies? So a lot of these questions require both empirical and theoretical research. Another topic, again, itself a very broad tent. What is the effect of demographics and income inequality on the financial system? One topic there is secular stagnation. Where is the equilibrium real interest rate going, and what are the factors that drive it? Under demographics, you could ask, does aging drive down real interest rates because of different saving propensities of the old versus everybody else? Inequality, does high saving propensity of the rich versus everybody else have a tendency to drive down interest rates? Monetary policy effectiveness. Again, there for demographics, you could ask, is the expenditure of the old less sensitive to interest rates than that of everybody else? For inequality, is the expenditure of the poor, not just the poor necessarily, but the poor in the middle class, more or less sensitive to interest rates than that of the very rich? And finally, the link between inequality, leverage, and crises is itself something that requires more research, both for individual economies and for the cross-country between-country dimension. For individual economies, the question is how important is this link and what factors affect it? For the US economy, I show you here some graphs of what happened in the decades before the Great Recession and the Great Depression, and the solid line in each case shows you the household debt to GDP ratio, and the dotted line, the share of the top 5% in the income distribution. And you observe there over decades a strong co-movement that ultimately led to very high debt-to-income ratios, which incidentally were almost exclusively concentrated in the bottom 95% of the income distribution and not the top 5. And as we know from the work of Schulerich and Taylor, high private debt-to-income ratios are a strong predictor of financial fragility and ultimately financial crises. So there is, what I have shown in work with some co-authors is that the increase in income inequality can, in fact, explain up to 3/4 of the increase in debt in the United States prior to the Great Recession. And so, therefore, this is a major potential factor in financial fragility. But going back, this was only looking at the U.S. economy. Then there's also the question of how this would affect international capital flows, both net flows, i.e. current accounts, and gross flows. And even more broadly, how can monetary and macroprudential policies affect inequality? There have been several recent papers that have raised the possibility that monetary policy has a significant effect on income inequality, and that's something that needs to be pursued further, given that we have just seen that there's a potential link from that to financial fragility. So to conclude, these two examples have shown that theme five encompasses a very broad set of questions that traditionally would not have been thought of as central bank type questions. But they have potentially large financial stability implications. And financial stability obviously has always been a prominent aspect of central bank work, but following the Great Recession, even more so. And we therefore think that it makes sense to broaden the research agenda and to include these questions in our research agenda. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you very much. Is it all right if I speak sitting down? I can speak standing up, but I thought it might be a little less formal to do it sitting down. I'm going to speak about topics that sound and actually are very grand in the sense of being enormously important for a long period of time. I'm not being grand for the sake of it, and in evidence that I'm not a grand person, I should say that I support AFC Wimbledon. But we are at the beginning of two decades which will shape whether we have any chance of holding to 2 degrees centigrade, which will shape what kind of cities that we live in, and thus our chances beyond the next couple of decades of controlling emissions and getting them to fall. Why do I say that? Well, we've got four things going on which interact and give us an enormous opportunity, but also illustrate that delay is dangerous. The first is that we live in a period of quite extraordinary structural change in the world economy. 50% of the population of 7 billion is currently in cities. That's 3.5 billion people. That will rise by the middle of the century to 70% of something over 9 billion. So that's over 6 or around 6.5 billion people. So we're going to move from 3.5 billion in cities to 6.5 billion people in cities in the next 35 years. And you can see from the way I've got to that number that it's likely to be more or less right in terms of ballpark. It just says over the next 35 years, 50%, 70% in cities. The locus of economic activity is changing remarkably. I've been teaching development economics now for more than 45 years. 25 years ago, we used to say that two-thirds of the output is in the rich countries. It's now about a half, and 25 years from now, it will probably be about a third. So if you look at the international division of labor and where people live, basic questions of what we mean by structural transformation, it is of a quite remarkable pace. And you have to use, we're brought up, you know, middle class people don't use strong adjectives, but this is a very powerful effect. The second is that technical progress is probably as fast as we've ever seen. If you look at digital, materials, bio, it is quite remarkable, the pace of technological change. That's the second big thing I want to note. The third is, as I've already mentioned, that the next 20 years will determine whether they've got any chance of holding to 2 degrees centigrade. Basically, we have to peak emissions for the world sometime rather soon. And at the moment, it looks as if world emissions will peak perhaps 15 years from now. And if that happens, it would mean that we have very little chance of holding to 2 degrees. We're emitting about 50 billion tons of CO2 equivalent now. That should be substantially below 40 in 2030 if we're to have a reasonable chance of holding to 2 degrees. 50 now down to, well, 40 or perhaps well below 40. We're headed for something above 50 on the basis of current intentions towards Paris Agreement. So that period is enormously important. Of course, there's a ratchet effect because this is a flow stock process, flows of emissions to stocks of greenhouse gases, and you get lock-in of very long-lived capital infrastructure assets. So delay is dangerous, and we're selling off. We are, even with moderately optimistic view of the Paris Agreement at the end of this year, set on a very dangerous path. And of course, the fourth thing is that in this place, you know it better than anybody else, interest rates are on the floor. So that surely, put those things together, there's an enormous opportunity here to foster the kind of investment that's necessary to make the kind of changes that I'm describing. And in so doing, we would make our cities much less congested, much less polluted, altogether much more livable. We'd be saving lots of biodiversity. There'd be all kinds of benefits from efficiency and congestion and avoided congestion, absolute pollution, all kinds of benefits beyond, of course, the very fundamental one of radically reducing the risk of climate change. So it's 15 or 20 years of fundamental importance to the world. How does one go about making the changes? Well, you've got to make the policies to drive the investments. But the finance, for the financing of those investments will also be a very powerful determinant of where we're able to go. And let's just look very quickly at some numbers. Roughly speaking, the world will be investing over the next 15 years or so $6 trillion per annum in infrastructure, maybe $4 trillion of that $6 trillion in outside the rich countries. That's particularly where the growth of cities, energy systems, and so on is taking place, and of course, where the big bulk of the population is. So the question then becomes, if we're trying to influence this process, we can have a long discussion about the policies, and you can think of some of them. But let me focus, since because of where we are, on the finance. And we have to ask ourselves the question, how can that finance be mobilized in ways which make it easier to do these, to do those investments in ways that are clean? Clearly a big combination of policy on the one hand and finance on the other. You can't get investment on that kind of scale just through public investment, and you probably wouldn't want to anyway. So you couldn't do that on this kind of scale through public investment. I think we have to ask ourselves the question, what role can development banks play in this process, and how can the role of the private sector in this process be enhanced? That seems to me to be a moderately well-defined research question, and we can start to think about how that might go. Having worked for 10 years as a chief economist in development banks, first the EBRD and then the World Bank, I have some understanding of how those work and some understanding of the potential. And there's an economist, as some of you have heard of, who thought of ways of financing these banks with the brilliant idea of paid-in capital and callable capital. That was what John Maynard Keynes proposed, probably thought it up one evening. And what you do is you pay in to this development bank, say, $20 billion, and you allow, but you then promise, if things get very bad, to contribute, say, another $80 billion, which is callable. So the $20 billion is paid in, the $80 billion is callable, and then you have one-to-one gearing ratios. So you borrow very cheap. And so you've got a big multiplier on the public money that goes in, on the amounts that it can borrow and then lend out. That's a very powerful multiplier. And if these development banks are run well, like the EBRD, they partner with private sector flows in a very strong way. If the development bank is present in a deal, the objective probability of policy risk goes down. The objective probabilities involved in policy risk goes down because governments are much less likely to monkey around if a development bank has got a slice of the deal. It was very important when we were investing Central Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union in EBRD. You can convene much better. And if Goldman Sachs rings you up and says, Nick, here, I've got this great deal for you, just give me the money when I tell you and relax, it's all going to be wonderful, you would be rather cautious. But if the EBRD rings you up and says that we've gone quite a long way, we've got this partner, you trust them. And there's evidence, well, I won't go on too far down this road. So I've just referred to two ways, I could go on, but there are two ways in which they're genuinely strong forces for multiplication with the private sector. One is the reduction in policy risk, and two is trust. Now, these are things that none of this is government subsidy. This is the different institutional structure of these banks. Now, they can be used and misused as tools of beneficence by powerful or dictatorial governments. But I think we've learnt a bit about how to do them reasonably well. So that's one response. There, a number of, you've got very big, of course, pension funds looking for long-term investments to match their liabilities. The subjects I'm talking about are assets with very strong potential returns in the long term, if policy is sound and if policy stays sound. Now, there must be scope there also for central banking authorities, just like in multilateral development banks, to explore ways in which they can be those who help foster the kind of investment structure that I've described. So these are big numbers, big issues, big roles, but that's because the problem is a big problem, and the potential to act on our cities and energy systems and land use now is so powerful. So that's my suggested research project. I could go on about unburnable carbon, but I probably shouldn't. I would just observe that the proven reserves, the reserves that fall into that category with all the criteria for what proven means, if burnt, would be roughly three times, emit CO2 roughly three times the total that's consistent with holding to 2 degrees with a 50-50 chance. So you can't simultaneously believe two things, that all the proven reserves can be burnt and the world can hold for two degrees with a 50-50 probability. You can't simultaneously believe those two things. Unless there's an extraordinarily rapid expansion of carbon capture and storage, which seems to be rather unlikely. You can't logically believe those two things. And what many oil companies ask us to do is to say, forget this stuff about holding to 2 degrees, we ain't never gonna manage to do that. If you believe that, then there's a tremendous amount of risk of climate change impact that you better be preparing for right now. And of course, correlated risk, it's risk of my house having a local flood is perhaps has something to do with my leaving the dishwasher on. The probability of whole areas being flooded are the kind of things, and big areas, very big areas, like Bangladesh or Florida, is those probabilities are the kind of things we have to think about when we talk about climate change. So the unburnable carbon is a very big story. If policy is sensible, those assets will be much less valuable. That's why I was particularly... I don't read all your letters, Mark, but this letter was public, so I hope it was all right to read it. It was your letter to Joan Whalley, and this is where I'll stop. Letter to Joan Whalley, MP, Chair of the Environment Audit Committee, of 30th of October 2014. And talking of stranded assets, Mark, you said, in light of these discussions, we will be deepening and widening our inquiry into the topic, and I expect the Financial Policy Committee to also consider this issue as part of its regular horizon scanning work on financial stability risks. Well, I hope what I've said, and of course what Mark was very much on top of, illustrates why that's so important to do that. Let me stop there.
Thanks, Nick. Tim.
Well, thank you very much. I always struck me as miraculous that the Bank of England can't even spell my name right, and yet is able to conjure money from thin air. And I wondered how this was. I got this pound. And, it's difficult to do this with the adrenaline flowing, so, yeah.
Oh, very good.
Behind Andy Haldane's ear, that's where it comes from. I don't deserve applause for a trick like that. I did want to teach you a magic trick that I think really does work. And I was sort of provoked into doing this by Andy's very kind invitation. He said, "Will you come and talk for 10 minutes about all the problems in the world, except climate change? Nick will deal with that. So just everything else." And it struck me as such a sort of large and sprawling kind of like everything. But it's important that we think about these things. It is important that we think about these things and we pay attention to these things. So how do we do it? So I'm going to tell you how I think the bank should think about just everything, all the unknown unknowns. Before I do that, I want to say a little bit about cryptocurrencies. I've been talking to Izzy Kaminska, my colleague at the FT, who knows more about cryptocurrencies, I think, than anybody in this room. And I'm having taken advice from her, I now feel confident that I'm able to tell you about the future of Bitcoin. What is going to happen? Yes, I've got rid of that. What's going to happen to Bitcoin? People know about Bitcoin. People, confident nods, you all know about Bitcoin? Good, I was hoping someone was going to explain it to me. So Bitcoin is Bitcoin's kind of two things. Bitcoin is both an asset and a way of recording payments. So it's simultaneously a sort of digital gold, has no value, but it is it's in finite supply, and everyone can see that it's in finite supply, and therefore, you know, if people want to hold it, and it's, you know, if there's demand and there's finite supply, then it has a value. And so at the moment it has a value. It's a very volatile value. Kind of like digital gold, more volatile even than gold, more mysterious even than gold, but it's there. The other thing that Bitcoin is a set of rules about writing down transactions and keeping track of transactions. So it is, I mean, normally if I were to give Andy a pound, I can just give him a pound and we all agree that that's a pound. But another way of doing it, the Bitcoin-y sort of way of doing it, is to say, look, I'm going to give Andy a pound. Well, I'll give him a Bitcoin. I'm going to give him a Bitcoin. It's worth a lot more than a pound. It's about $300. And everybody here agrees. I just said I was going to do that. Andy says he's received it. I say I've given it. And we all vote. Did it happen? And if enough people vote and say it happened, we're going to write it down somewhere where everyone can see it. And that's how value is transferred. That's basically how Bitcoin works. It's a bit more complicated than that, but that's the basic idea. So you've got all of these. It's like a cross between Visa and BitTorrent. So distributed computers all over the world, just keeping track of all of these transactions. So that's what it is. What's going to happen to it? Well, it's quite simple. Bitcoin's value has gone up and down. It's currently, as I say, $200 or $300. There was a point where it was $1,200. There was a point where it was basically nothing. So as this year, 2015, progresses, there'll be another boom. The value of Bitcoin is going to rise, and it's going to rise, and there'll be more and more media articles. The value will go through $1,000. Then the value will go through $2,000. Never been anywhere near $2,000 before. More and more people will write about it, and asset managers will start launching exchange-traded funds based on synthetic Bitcoin, so you can sort of put them in your ISA. And it's going to get bigger and bigger. It'll go through $5,000. It'll go through $10,000. People will fear that they're missing out on the whole Bitcoin thing. And then, of course, the frauds will start. There have been frauds already. There's actually a paper out there by Mary Vasek and Tyler Moore, two computer scientists. They've already discovered nearly 200 Bitcoin frauds. 13,000 people have been involved. About $11 million has been stolen. But this is going to become mainstream. You know, people will be phoning into Paul Lewis on Radio 4 and saying, that nice man told me he was going to give me some Bitcoin, but I don't understand what a wallet is. And it's going to get bigger and bigger. Which in some ways is a sign of maturity. I mean, we don't abandon the pounds just because con men like to be paid in pounds. But it's symbolic of a problem as well. And then the real problem becomes clear. This is something that the economist Kevin Dowd has pointed out. There's actually a fundamental economy of scale in the way that these decentralized computers process the blockchain. The blockchain is this list of all these transactions. And that's a bit weird, because the whole thing is it's supposed to be distributed. But if it's a fundamentally monopolistic, it's already become a bit of an oligopoly. But as the industry consolidates more and more and more, you have this system where instead of everybody here agreeing that I gave Andy a Bitcoin, Andy owns all the computers, and he says I gave him a Bitcoin. And who no one else can disprove it. So the stage is set by 2016, 2017, 2018 for massive fraud and the entire collapse of the system. So that's what's going to happen to Bitcoin. I say that, but actually, I mean, that's not actually true. It's a nice story. It may be reassuring. We could call the story Bitcoin. We write a little short story, publish it in a science fiction book. The Bitcoin story. That's not actually what's going to happen. I'll tell you what's really going to happen. What's really going to happen is the price of Bitcoin is going to keep collapsing. And by the end of 2015, this currency will be worth next to nothing. And the spotlight of the financial press will move elsewhere, and people will stop talking about it. But a small group of true believers will continue to work on what's really fundamental about this technology, which is the decentralized payment processing of payments, the blockchain. And it turns out that the blockchain is just too unwieldy. It's not going to work for replacing the dollar or replacing the pound. Why would anybody have ever thought that you could keep a track of all of the transactions that have ever happened in the history of humanity? It doesn't matter how big the data is going to get. That's not practical. But what is practical is for smaller independent blockchains to start processing on behalf of particular interest groups. So Airbnb start using a blockchain to process transactions and to barter rooms. By 2017, you'll be able to use a blockchain to unlock your digital self-driving taxi and to pay for it. By 2018, you download software onto your computer, run your babysitting circle or your prostitution ring or whatever you want to do that involves these sort of these decentralized processing transactions that the authorities can't keep control of. Of course, people don't use bitcoins themselves because that's absurd. They prefer this currency that's made by the Bank of England. You could call it the Threadneedle coin if you like, but most people call it the pound. And the dollar is also popular. But decentralized processing really catches on, and the blockchain, it turns out, is what's really important. And this is a story as well. We can give this story a name. We call it Daisy Chains. All the thousand flowers blooming, all the little blockchains all over the world starting up. I doubt that either of these stories will come true. I don't really know. I don't know much about Bitcoin. I don't think any of us do, apart from Izzy. She knows a lot about Bitcoin. Even Izzy doesn't know what's going to happen to Bitcoin. Nobody knows. But the storytelling that I've engaged in is something I think the Bank of England could benefit from. When we're dealing with very broad, multidisciplinary, vague, open-ended problems, we're trying to get lots and lots of people into the room, shake up our thinking, tell us things we don't know. I mean, Donald Rumsfeld's famous unknown unknowns, but all the unknown unknowns, they're known to somebody. Somebody somewhere knows, somebody somewhere has thought about it. It's just we've never talked to that person, or we didn't understand them when they spoke to us. So what is the mechanism by which we get all of those conversations happening? And a personal confession, I used to work at Shell, which specializes in scenario analysis. I used to work for a guy called Vince Cable. I don't know what happened to him. Shell uses scenario analysis, and I think for certain purposes, it's tremendously important, it's tremendously useful. Now, by scenarios, I don't mean stress testing scenarios. I don't mean that kind of thing. I don't mean the fan charts. What I mean is a persuasive, vivid story about the future. I really mean science fiction, but more than one persuasive, vivid story about the future. A story that you can listen to and really believe, and then another story that contradicts it, that you can also listen to and believe. And the first thing that does is makes you realize, well, we don't really know. The second thing it does is it gets us to think both about qualitative and quantitative aspects about the future. I mean, my favorite counterexample is IBM. Apparently, IBM around 1980 issued forecasts of global demand for computers, and the forecasts were very, very accurate. They were really good. But the forecast, the number on the graph was over time, the y-axis was global demand for millions of instructions per second. So it didn't talk about the form in which those instructions might be consumed, the software that might run on them, the fact that they might be on our desks, in our phones, in our fridges, the fact that some upstart called Bill Gates might write some software that would run on some of the, would use some of these millions of instructions per second. So you had a perfect forecast that told you nothing that really mattered. Whereas if IBM had started telling itself stories, well, computers are going to get cheaper. What does that mean? Who might use them? How might they want to use them? Amateurs will use them. Amateurs want easy software. If IBM had engaged in scenarios, in stories, rather than in quantitative forecasts, it might have learned something. I'm not saying we don't want quantitative forecasts, but we need something else. The other thing about these stories is a story is intrinsically multidisciplinary. You can talk about a perspective from anthropology, you can talk to foreigners, you can talk to the mathematicians, the biologists, you can talk to all kinds of people, and they can all contribute to the story, because everybody can have an opinion about the future. Not everyone can have an opinion about data mining, or not everyone can have an opinion about a randomized controlled trial, but everybody can have an opinion about the future. That means you can get all sorts of experts, all sorts of different perspectives in the room. And the final thing is they can talk in a safe way. I think it's not very easy to say, Governor, I think that your strategy for X, Y, or Z is wrong. I think you're making a mistake. You're doing it wrong. That's hard. I mean, I can say it. It may be hard for other people in the room to say it. What is easier to say, what is much easier to say, is, there's this possible world out there. I mean, I'm not saying it's going to happen, but there's this possibility. How does our strategy work in that world? Is our strategy built for a different world? And then you can have a much safer discussion. Well, which of these two stories do we believe? Many years ago, I worked on scenarios for the future of mental health provision in the UK. And I was doing it for a mental health charity. And we worked out these two scenarios. We were about halfway through the process. And the chief executive of the charity came in. And I said, OK, here's our two scenarios. I quickly outlined them, like the Bitcoin scenario. And he said, that's really interesting. I don't really believe your first scenario. I don't think it's plausible. But your second one, that's the world we're heading for. I've got to go to a meeting, but my deputy will talk to you. And he went off. The deputy came in. So I outlined the scenarios to the deputy. And the deputy said, I don't really buy your second scenario. It doesn't seem very plausible to me. But your first scenario, I think that's the world we're heading for. Well, I don't know which scenario really came true, but I know we were able to generate a safe space for a conversation between these two people who didn't even realize that they disagreed with each other about something very fundamental. I mean, there is a very important role, of course, for quantitative analysis, for rigorous analysis, for the academic research outputs that Andy and his team have outlined today. But there's also a role for stories, because even though we can't see into the future, sometimes talking about the future helps us understand the present. Thanks very much.
Well, thank you, Tim. So we've got 10 minutes or so for questions. So what I'll do is I'll take first two or three questions and we'll try and block them together. So who wants to kick off? Yes.
Thanks. Michael raised a question about the interest responsiveness of rich people. Now, part of the answer to that is to look at the balance sheets that they hold. So this illustrates the general point that balance sheets are really important, particularly for households. So if you were to carry out this thought experiment in Japan, where even rich people hold a lot of very safe assets, savings accounts and so on, liquid assets, you'd get a very different answer from the answer you'd get in the US, where rich people in particular would have much of their assets in the stock market. And obviously the stock market is much more responsive to interest rates. In fact, the direction of response will be different. In Japan, people who own liquid assets will typically spend less when the interest rate goes down. In the US, people in the stock market will spend more when the interest rate goes down. So balance sheets are really crucial. And my general comment about the document actually was that when you think about balance sheet effects versus risk versus the risk channel. I think the balance sheet channel, balance sheet channel is really important for households. The risk channel perhaps is more important for firms. So that's a general point.
Anybody want to follow up? Yeah? Just over there.
Thank you very much. I was going to ask the panel about what they thought about the Brixton pound, but more seriously, I'll pick up the issue about climate risk and systemic risk. Nick Robbins from the UNEP inquiry. I think this is really a first to have a central bank putting environmental systemic risk into its research program, and it's incredibly timely. Other central banks, People's Bank of China, the Central Bank of Brazil, Bangladesh, and so on, are looking at similar issues from very, very different perspectives, very, very different starting points. And I suppose it's as much a process question, but how could the panel think about actually starting more international research programs, because many of the issues that you're dealing with are actually shared, particularly thinking around actually practical tools and methodologies to enable researchers and also supervisors deal with some of these big uncertain issues. Thank you.
So the third one before we get answers. Phil, do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I guess implicitly Nick's referring to an idea that we might have climate change bonds almost that could relate to the future of climate change and be related to the degree of it. I was also thinking, though, on the longevity side. I know that there have been some people working on longevity bonds, which could be a way of hedging longevity risk. I just wondered whether the panel think that the UK government should be much more proactive in that, in debt management, and well, that might have interesting implications for the bank's work as well.
Great, thanks. So let's start with, are we doing enough on balance sheets, I think, which not a new question, actually, I should think, but that doesn't mean to say it's not a relevant question. Michael, do you want to?
Yeah, I do. I come at this from the modeling perspective, but then, of course, that would immediately have consequences for how you would like to do empirical work. And I totally agree with you that balance sheets should be front and center, both balance sheets of the household sector and balance sheet of corporate sector and balance sheet of the banking sector, with a particular emphasis on how financial balance sheets are actually created. Meaning that they're not always just intermediating some funds, but they're also that what is involved is also the creation of funds out of thin air, not just by central banks, but also the banking system. And so that should be front and center. That an understanding of that should be front and center. And also what that could lead to is when you do macroeconomic analysis, it leads you to conclude that there are potentially non-linearities when you run into financial problems, into financial crises, because when you hit very high loan-to-value ratios or when banks get very close to the Basel ratio, et cetera, you get non-linear behavior of economic models, which is absolutely critical. And once you understand these things, then you can intelligently do empirical work that is motivated by understanding how balance sheets are actually created. So I think that should be front and center in our research agenda. Yes, I agree.
Nick, do you want to tackle some of the climate change?
Yes. How do we organise international research? One way of doing it is for the G20 countries to ask directly for the major international financial institutions to work on a topic. I was chief economist of the World Bank, and we had quite a big research department. We felt obligated to be responsive to what the major shareholders were asking us to do. We know that China is in the chair of the G20 in 2016. Of course, being China, they plan ahead, and they're already very much concerned with what their subject matter should be. So it seems to me an opportunity there is to partner with China. Of course, China's the most important country on almost everything, and certainly on climate change. You've also got Zhou Xiaochuan and Lo Jiwei, the head of the central bank and finance ministers, who take the subject very seriously. We have a governor of central bank here that takes the subject very seriously. I don't know who the Chancellor's Exchequer next year will be. Maybe you'll let me know.
Or even this year.
Christine Lagarde takes it seriously. I think you've got the potential, that's one potential move that could get quite a lot of good researchers activated quite quickly. I mean, there are other routes too, but that's one to start with. Phil mentioned climate change bonds. There does seem to be an appetite, sorry, I haven't got the numbers marshalled here, but they've grown very quickly, as we know, over these last few years. And it seems that if you ask people where they think the investment opportunities and the important places to look to investment, as well as there being opportunities, a lot of people see much more efficient, less congested, less polluting, low carbon growth as the core of the growth story of the future, and seem to be willing, as it were, to lend money in a way that's oriented towards that kind of investment. I mean, you can do it in terms of different ways, different kinds of kickers according to policy performance and so on. But I suspect it's not so much that. I suspect that it's people seeing this as rather an attractive way to invest for them personally, but also a place where the returns are quite high, or at least no less than they would be somewhere else. That's also the experience of AP4, you know, a big pension fund in Sweden that has gone for decarbonizing their investment portfolio. They're very big, so they're invested in a lot of different sectors. So they just look at this particular sector, whether it be retail or oil or whatever, and ask itself, which is, on terms of emissions, which is performing the best, which is performing the worst. And they're big enough that they've got quite reasonable size holdings, and then they chop off the worst in a sector and say why. Now, that is a much more intelligent way of motivating behavior than divesting out of oil. I mean, divesting out of oil is like a blunderbuss. It doesn't actually point to particular, or put incentives very directly in the way of particular companies, other than just give up oil. But if you do it in this way, you can actually get incentives going for companies in an industry which are performing badly, and what many see as a key dimension, to perform better. And they found that in the period since, they found that their performance has actually improved, just in straight, plain vanilla financial terms, has improved since they followed that kind of policy. So I do think there are tremendous opportunities there. They have to be done wisely and designed in the right way. As I said, I don't think straight divestment out of anything to do with hydrocarbons necessarily makes sense. But there are ways of doing it in ways that can give the right kind of micro incentives to firms.
Tim, are we too domestic in our storytelling? Should we be telling more international stories? You're very international in your view. Bitcoin's everywhere.
Yes.
And nowhere.
Well, yeah, we do need to consider the international situation, and of course that's always gets very difficult. That gets very hard. It gets more complicated. So the nice thing about stories is that stories enable you to make choices about a lot of complicated information, fit a lot of complicated information into a story in a way that people will remember, and it will, you know, makes a certain logical, consistent sense. We should talk more about the international situation, but we should talk more about technological change. We should talk more about anthropology. We should talk, you know, we should. There are all kinds of things. We've heard it throughout the day. There are all sorts of extra perspectives that should be incorporated. But of course, there's only so much time, and there's only so much attention, which is why I think the scenario methodology can help. It helps to focus attention when sometimes today it feels like we're just being shown this enormous empty filing cabinet that the bank is proposing to fill, all the labels and all of the different folders, And it's it, in some ways it's inspiring as a research agenda, but it's also daunting and it is empty. It's all, you know, to be we're gonna put some research in here. How can we fill all of the different categories, all the different things we could talk about, and everything we mentioned, there were five questions that mentioned something else we could also do. How on earth can we manage it? And that's what the storytelling scenario approach does. It enables you to take a certain route through that filing cabinet and to take 10 or 15 topics of interest that would be completely unwieldy, somehow to put them together into a story that someone's going to remember.
So just to have the last word, because it's sort of my right, really. It's really interesting, coming rather later in my career as a central banker, to become an insurance regulator. And the reason is, it's really very interesting, and partly in this country because there's far too much obsession with banks. But secondly, because when you get into insurance regulation, you get into a time horizon which is much longer than most of the things that central banks do. And you come right up against longevity, and you come right up against climate change in a very real sense. And I say this because I would encourage everybody to want to think about how we can do research which actually is involved with insurance regulation, because the real challenges for life, particularly, well, it's not just for life insurance, actually, but it's all particularly in that area, is that these long-term issues are real. They're there. And you know, we're having to deal with them now in that sense. And it's an area that has actually, I think, been pretty shaded from sort of full contact with research. I say that, and the actuaries who work for me will beat me up tomorrow, but I'll say it. Fostering those sorts of connections and that sort of work would, I think, be great. So, Tim talked about mining Bitcoin. So one of the things we do in the Bank of England these days is mine deputy governors. And you've had almost the full set today, but we've saved Ben for last. So I'll hand over to Ben Broadbent, who's going to make the closing remarks.
Hi, thanks very much. Yes, that's the reason this day has been so long. We had to fit in every deputy governor. So I will be very brief, especially because I can almost hear the corks coming out of the wine bottles. Now, the first time I spent any time at the Bank of England 20 years ago, someone told me a story, not Tim's kind of story, a reportedly true historical story, although, like many stories about this institution, it involved Montagu Norman, and like many stories about Montagu Norman, it may or may not, in fact, be true. He was, at least in that sense, a legendary figure. Anyhow, Norman was governor when the first professional economists were employed by the Bank of England, and the story involves his welcoming remarks to one particularly distinguished figure. "Let me be clear about your duties," Norman is meant to have said. "You are not here to tell us what to do. You're here to tell us why we did it." Plus ça change, I can hear some of my economists saying. Now, intuition has its place, of course, and it's worth pointing out that there are great swathes of economics devoted precisely to Norman's research program, if one could call it that, namely treating the policymaker as just another optimizing agent and seeking to explain the way policy behaves rather than suggesting how it should. But as we know, there are many settings in which optimizing behavior by individuals will give suboptimal outcomes from the perspective of social welfare. There are circumstances, to take an example that might or might not be relevant for us, in which two policy instruments are best set in a coordinated fashion. And nor, of course, is intuition reliable. It apparently does well in some areas, especially those in which decisions have to be made very rapidly. But even then, it's informed decision that matters. The stuff that works is developed over time and with experience. And in many areas, informal judgment does demonstrably worse than even the simplest of analytical rules. Famously, the algorithm developed by the economist Ollie Ashenfelter to judge the quality of a mature wine, and I say algorithm, it was just a linear regression driven by three, I think, variables, measuring conditions at the time the grapes were grown. outperformed by a wide margin the predictions of the so-called experts. Now, those experts weren't best pleased with the stuffiness one might perhaps expect of such a publication. Wine magazine said, "This formula's self-evident silliness invites disrespect." But silly or not, the experts were apparently even sillier than this most elementary bit of econometrics. And to take an example closer to home and a much more serious one, it was arguably ill thought out intuition, in this case, a misplaced association between the country's international standing and its monetary regime, that at the time of Norman's governorship persuaded the British authorities to return to the gold standard at the pre-war price. That necessitated a 20% drop in the price of goods and services within a couple of years, big deflation, you might call it, none of your wimpy 0.5% a year Japanese-style deflation, and in order to produce it, widespread economic misery. So intuition must be informed, and policy is improved by good research, and with more policy responsibilities demanded of us, we need more good research, and that's why we're launching this initiative, and very welcome it is too. And the only thing I really want to say about it is that I hope it's something that endures. We certainly intend that it should, because it will take time and effort to extract the useful results we need. We are not experimental scientists. We cannot make random moves in policy simply to discover their effects, still less hold constant everything else that matters. And if we are still uncertain about the precise transmission or impact of changes in official interest rates using data sets that are decades or even centuries long, we should not expect to arrive very quickly at precise and final answers about the impact of some of our new policy tools. And in the meantime, we should guard against prejudice and overconfidence ourselves. It is easy to laugh at the wine expert trumped by the simple regression. But economists too, of course, can cling on to ideas even in the face of conflicting evidence, or choose that evidence selectively to support their prior beliefs, wherever those may come from. It wasn't his sommelier, but his economic advisers down the road at the Treasury, but also in this building, who persuaded Churchill of the wisdom of the return to gold. And it was the arch critic of that policy, Maynard Keynes, who once said, or clearly said, one should be able to change one's mind. And indeed, perhaps from time to time, he himself did so. "I find myself moved," he wrote in 1946, just before he died, "to remind contemporary economists that the classical teaching embodied some permanent truths of great significance. If it were not so, we could not have got on even so well as we have for many decades past. These expedients," and he was referring here to his proposals at Bretton Woods, "will work better, and we shall need them less if the classical medicine is also at work. They are an attempt to use what we've learned from modern experience and modern analysis, not to defeat, but to implement the wisdom of Adam Smith." This from the man who is only quoted now as poo-pooing classical economics. And indeed, a couple of years beforehand, Keynes told Austin Robinson, husband of Joan, that at a dinner in Washington, surrounded by acolytes, he'd found himself to be, quote, "the only non-Keynesian at the table." So we should be humble, and we too should be open-minded. And in order to avoid being prematurely trapped by any single idea, we should encourage constructive research into many of them, which is why we're appealing to all of you for help, and why we're grateful to everyone who's come. And I would also like to express my gratitude to all those who've helped to organize today's events, to all the speakers, and above all, to Sujit Kapata and to Andy Haldane for developing this really exciting plan. So now I think you all deserve a break. I cannot promise you anything with a particularly high ranking on Aschenfelter's scale, but somewhere, I think downstairs, there is There is some wine waiting. Thank you very much.